Hey, good morning. Welcome to New Hope Church. If you are a guest at New Hope today, thanks for being here. There are guest cards in the pew in front of you. We would love for you to fill it out, drop it in the offering bag. Let us know of your visit. We promise not to harass you or annoy you. We will send some things to you in the mail. Want you to know what's going on around here, but we would just love to know of your presence here. Hey, before I forget, because I don't have this written down in my notes, Brandon and Dasha, stand up, would you please? Two young people who grew up in our high school group. They got married. He's in the military. He's home for a few weeks. Welcome. Good to see you. Y'all look good. All right? Is he being a good husband? Okay, that's what I like to hear. Okay. I never asked this question. Is she being a good wife? Careful. Okay. All right, good. All right. Great. Good to see you. Welcome today. All right, Chris Bishop. Walk up front, man, so everybody get a good look at you. Say hello to our new Pastor Bishop, all right? His picture's in the bulletin, all right? He's got a beautiful wife and a couple of handsome boys, all right? What a first week on the job he's had. He shows up to his rental house, and the landlord didn't have any water for him, all right? So we got high school kids there. They unload them. We got some adult leaders there. They help them get unloaded. Air conditioning's working. No water. Nice landlord, though. He puts them up in a hotel for a couple days. Says, County of Fresno messed up. They said they'd be out first thing Monday morning. They got out Tuesday afternoon late, all right? But his landlord puts him up for two nights. Last night he says, nah, man, we're just staying here, all right? We're going to hang out here. Just in case you wanted to know, his landlord is Mark Addis. Okay, just thought I'd pass that on. But Mark took care of it. It wasn't his fault, and it's all been handled, all right? He's also become acquainted with Valley Children's Hospital. All right, already had his old son at the hospital till 2 in the morning. We think allergic reaction to a particular nut that he may have eaten. We're not quite sure. But anyway, yeah, it's good to know right off the bat where the hospital is.
Just checking the city out.
All right, yeah. Yeah, actually, he went to two urgent cares and Clovis Community Hospital and Valley Children's all in one night. So he knows the town pretty well by now. But anyway, say good morning, all right, to Chris, all right? We're excited to have him here. We've got, he's going to have a really small group this morning, all right, at 10:45 over there, because one of their volunteer leaders, Bill Eccles, took their small group, which is about 11 of the high school kids, over to the coast for the weekend. And so because of that, we postponed something that we were going to do today, and that just gives you all one more opportunity to share. Next week, we are going to be presenting a gift to Robert Hutchinson, our outgoing youth pastor of 12 and a half years, a gift of thanks from all of us in the church family. If Robert ministered to you, whether it was to your kids in high school, whether it was in other ways in which he was involved in ministry around here, just as a church member, you appreciate his commitment of 12 and a half years to the youth of our community. You can put a little contribution in an envelope, write on the front of the envelope, either Hutch, youth pastor, farewell, whatever you write, we'll know what it's for. You can write mini pastor on it, drop it in the offering bag next week. The 9:15 service, we're going to make a presentation of him of gratitude for his years of service here at the church. So you have one more Sunday now to get that done, all right, if you would like to take care of that. And that other little thing I told you about, because he's standing out there, just drop it in the offering. All right, good. Gene Sperling is back. He's busy right now, all right? He's doing one of his church things. He's delivering somebody that he picked up and brought to 8 o'clock service, but he'll be here back in a few minutes. Jerry, you're smiling as big as he was when I saw him. You guys had a great 50th anniversary trip, didn't you? Yeah, all right, they had a grand time, and we've heard good reports about it. Gene will be selling tickets after this service out in the pavilion for the Grizzlies game. The info is in the bulletin. They'll be on sale for this week and two more weeks after today between the services. So see him and pick up your tickets, all right? Thank you for all of your help for World Changers last week. With a little fiasco and those lists gone missing, everybody stepped to the plate last week, signed up again. Everybody showed up. We had people with transportation, both delivering as well as pickup. It went smoothly. Thank you. The needs of all those kids were taken care of, and we appreciate it so very, very much. An announcement that Ms. Fawn sent to me last night that I want to pass on to you. It's a last-minute thing. It's why it's not in your bulletin. As you know, Teresa Hutchinson, who was our former office secretary 12 years, is getting some help for some challenges that she's just sort of put off for the years. She's doing very, very well. In fact, a six-month program she has finished in 2 months, which is pretty remarkable. And so she is going to be entering the second phase of the program, which will send her to Pennsylvania. And she'll be leaving on July 30th. So this next Saturday, she has a 12-hour furlough. And so any of the ladies of the church, if you would like to offer her encouragement, tell her you're praying for her, you want to be a good send-off to her, lunch has been arranged. All right, it's going to be at Andiamo's Italian Restaurant. That is on Shaw, just across from Sierra Vista Mall. It's at the corner of Sunnyside and Clovis. It will be at 12 noon next Saturday, right? It's this coming Saturday, so you only got 6 days, all right? $15 for the lunch. That includes everything, your meal, your drink, your tax, your gratuity. Fawn says, bring cash. She doesn't trust your checks. it does say cash. Yeah, but why would you say cash if you didn't? I mean, I... Oh, okay. All right. I understand. She's so much fun. Anyway, you'll just pay when you first arrive, but you can send Teresa off on the next leg of her journey with a very full heart from the women here at New Hope. There are a few needs that we can help meet, and you will be receiving in the email, right? Going out to ladies of the church, some things that... that you can pick up, and even if you can't make the lunch, you can drop them off here at the church. If you have any questions about what I've just said, you know, the cash, the check stuff, you can talk to Fawn, Don, or Nancy Horton in the office, all right? And they will be able to answer your questions. We have one new great-grandmother in our 8 o'clock service. Joe Newby has a new 8-pound, 8-ounce great-grandson. And he was told, his mom and dad were told a couple of weeks ago that he had a hole in his heart and he would probably have to immediately go to Children's Hospital and have a stent put in. Here's the good news. He did not have to go immediately to Children's Hospital. In fact, he went home the very next day. He will go to Children's Hospital next Friday, and they will evaluate the situation now that he's born, but there's no emergency crisis situations. And so we are very, very grateful for that. Let me highlight a few prayer requests that are not in your bulletin. Kim and Ozzie Fernandez texted me very, very early this morning about a special need in their family. Their son-in-law, his name is Jason Collins. His wife's name is Brandy. Jason was riding his motorcycle the latter part of the week. A car ran a red light and broadsided him. He is in a coma. He has bleeding on the brain and a blood clot in the brain. He is going to lose one of his legs. The damage is so bad they cannot repair it. But his situation is so unstable, they cannot do that surgery yet. So they would appreciate your prayers for him and his wife. They have 3 young children. And so please be in prayer for Jason Collins. Orville Little, this is Janet Mattson's father, Glenn Mattson's father-in-law. Orville has been an illustration a couple of times this year in some of my sermons. He's a gentleman who influenced me early in my life, was our Sunday school superintendent and deacon in the church I grew up in. Loves the Lord. He's 86 years old. His breathing capacity is down to less than 30%. He is home under hospice care right now. Would appreciate you remembering to pray for him. Marcia Crew had a very difficult week this past week with some health concerns. Requested prayer. Joe Avila's brother-in-law, Bruce, from Layton. Nobody goes to Layton by accident. You got to want to go there to find it, okay? It's kind of in... what's that zone out in the ocean? The Bermuda Triangle. That's kind of where Layton is in the Bermuda Triangle. You got to want to go there to find it, all right? But anyway, what a wonderful turnout. But just be praying for the Mosier family in Layton and for Joe's family. And our own church family, Greg and Shelley Parker. Greg's mother, Helen, part of our church for many, many years, but her health did not allow her the last couple of years to be here very often. She is now home with the Lord. Her and mom having a good visit today. And earlier this week, she went under hospice care at Heinz Hospice Home. I had a chance to visit her the day before, and we talked, laughed a little bit. She was responsive. I told her I was about ready to go, and I was going to kiss her on the forehead, and she puckered up and threw her chin up at me. And didn't she? Yeah. I said, Helen, I'm not kissing you on the lips. You're sick. All right? She just laughed. And we had prayer and left. So that will be my last memory of Helen, all right?
Yes. Yes, you may say something. Could I stop you?
No.
All right.
You're not going to stop me. was at work, I was in my work truck, and God, he just says, Shelly? I said, yes, God? And he goes, I love you. I said, God, I love you too. He said, you are my daughter. Yes, God, I'm your daughter. She is my daughter. Yes, God, mommy is your daughter. I just want to tell you guys that when you think that God is not watching, he doesn't care or whether he loves you or not, because I've been there, he does. He is mighty. He loves you. He gave his son for you. He is Almighty God. So share his love. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. Sermon number one today. All right. Well done. Shorter than the other one. Yeah, who said that? Way to go, Joe. Yes, ask the 8 o'clock service about that today. There's a young couple. Their last name is Stearns. I have not met them yet except on the telephone. I'll be meeting with them on Thursday. They're in their early 30s. They've had their first child, and he did not live past 48 hours. So we will be sharing in a service for them the following week. My daughter-in-law, Katie, her great aunt, who is 94 years old, was at their wedding earlier this year. She went home to be with the Lord this past week. And so if you would just be remembering Hylon and Katie and the rest of their family. Long-time Clovis family, Mike Vujicic. I always have a tough time saying their last name, Vujicic. Owned concrete, Clovis Concrete Pipe. Passed away. His service will be tomorrow morning at Clovis. So if you just remember their family and friends, they would deeply appreciate that. So just a few updates. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Would you come, please? Let's pray. Father, thank you for sharing your life with us. You share your life with us in the gift of your Son. At the moment that we become a Christian, and we become a Christian not because of good deeds, not because of hard work, not because of contributing lots of money, but Father, we become a Christian when we are humble enough to say, I am a sinner. I want you to be my Savior. And Father, at that moment, a relationship begins, a relationship that is forever, a relationship that is eternal, a relationship that Father, when what we perceive as death in this life comes, we know we never die. We simply change our suit of clothes. We move from the temporal to the eternal. We move from the unholy to the holy. We move from the imperfect to the perfect. And so, Father, we thank you for the comfort that that brings to families like the Parker family this week. And we say thanks. We trust you with those needs for the Fernandez family as they go through difficult times. We trust you with all the needs that we've talked about today and so many more that are personal and private to those of us who are gathered. Father, when your Son comes to live within us, he's a perfect gentleman. He never forces his way into the various rooms of our life. He waits for us to open the door and say, Lord Jesus, I want you to have access to all that I am. I want you to be the influence in everything that I do. He's a perfect gentleman. Lord, if there are some rooms that we have not opened up to you in our own life, I pray this would be the day of freedom. This would be the day of relinquishing our own authority and submitting to yours. Thank you for the joy and the privilege that is ours in giving and sharing. And we say thanks for how you will use it for the advancement not of New Hope Church, but of your kingdom work through New Hope Church. We trust you for our needs as your word is proclaimed. May our hearts be open to what you have to say to us. We say thanks. In the incredible name of Jesus Christ. Amen. You couldn't have chosen better music for today's sermon than you did today. I love it when God works that out. Just before we jump in the sermon, two prayer requests that I failed to mention that I want to make note of. Carol Gill is on her way back to the East Coast for a fitting for her nose. Please be praying for her in that adventure. And number two, we just got the word the end of the week that Shelly's dad, the biopsy came back. He does have lung cancer. We don't know the stage yet. That will be determined and will be informed later this week. So just be in prayer for both of them, the things they're facing in this coming week. God, you reign, and Jesus at the center is really at the heart of the message that we're looking at today. If you want to get ready in advance, we'll be looking at a few verses out of Romans chapter 13. Later in the sermon, it'll be up on the screen, just giving you a chance to go there. As I was thinking about my mama today, in light of Helen going home, Greg's mama, my mother loved gristles. That's kind of weird. I've never found them enjoyable. My mother loved to gnaw on a good gristle and a bone. Mama would have loved today's sermon because this one's a bit gristly, all right? This is a tough bone that we're going to gnaw on. It is the second in a series that we started last week called Twisted and Unseen. And I'm going to fly today. I found out in 8 o'clock service this is not a 25-minute sermon, all right? So just put your tinny runners on your ears and run with me today. I'm going to stick closer to notes than I normally do, but it's a pretty big subject. I don't want to divide it up. I want to try to get it all in today. Today's sermon is entitled, Says Who? Make Me. Do you remember ever saying that on an elementary playground? Okay, yeah. Says who? Make me. Rebellion equals freedom. We didn't actually know how to say it like that, but that is the premise in which many of us operated on from the time we were about 10 or 11 years old, right? I mean, it just made sense. The best way to get free is to rebel against the rules, to ignore the rules. Because as long as I keep the rules, I'm not really free. We grow up and that sort of morphs into something a bit more sophisticated, but it still means the same thing. As adults, we know that rebelling doesn't equal freedom because we know that prisons are full of people who rebelled and they lost their freedom. So we're too smart for that. But there's still this insidious twist that follows us into adulthood that sounds like, says who, make me. The adult version of the same twist goes like this. If I disagree with a rule, I'll ignore it. If I disagree with a rule, I'll disobey it. If I disagree with a rule, I can disregard it. It's the same twist as make me. It's just an adult version. It's somehow, I'm still going to be free and I'm still going to do what I want to do, but instead of just dismissing all authority, I will pick and choose one rule at a time, one law at a time, if I don't like the rule. If I think it's too extreme, redundant, irrelevant, if I think I've grown past that rule, I'll evaluate it, I'll disagree it, I'll disregard it, I'll question the authority of that rule, and in effect, I will say, says who, make me. Now, you may not be willing to admit this in church, but every single one of you listening to this message, in less than 5 minutes, you can think of an opportunity or a situation where you've done exactly that in your adult life. How about a posted 40-mile-an-hour speed limit? That's stupid. It ought to be at least 45 or 50. 55 on a freeway? That is crazy. It ought to be 65. It should be 75. How many of you have radar detectors in your truck? Yeah, a car. Okay, some of you are saying, I don't have a truck. Yeah, my case in point. What's the radar there for? All right, that because I'm going to break the rule. I've done it without radar, all right? I think I have pretty good vision, all right? I'm going to see them watching me, okay? We've all been there. What happened to the good old days when we could drive 80 miles an hour? We evaluate rule by rule. You know, you're filling out your own taxes, and you're doing your own deductions, and you're thinking, well, that ought to be a deduction. These certainly ought to be deductions. I mean, common sense says these are deductions. God would probably agree with me. These are deductions, so I can use them. Curfews, office supplies, tithing, whatever it is, there are many examples where we choose to disregard it. Here's an article from 15 years ago that illustrates our attitudes, and it hasn't gotten better since then, all right? John Leo is a columnist that wrote for the U.S. News & World Report. On October the 12th, 1998, he wrote an article called The Selling of Rebellion. Listen to what he wrote. Consider the recent ad, he said, for the Isuzu Rodeo. Remember that SUV Isuzu came out with called the Rodeo? I don't think it exists anymore, does it? I think it's gone, all right? Well, anyway, in that commercial, a grotesque giant in a business suit stomps out into a beautiful field, startling a deer, jamming skyscrapers, factories, and signs right into the ground. One of the giant's signs says, "Obey." But the narrator says, "The world has boundaries. Ignore them." Trying to trample the rodeo, the hapless giant trips over his own fence. The Isuzu zips past him, toppling a huge sign that says, "Rules." But the central message here is serious and strongly antisocial. It suggests we all should rebel against authority, social order, propriety, rules of any kind. Obeying rules are bad. Breaking rules, with or without your Isuzu, is good. But they weren't the only advertiser doing that kind of thing. Burger King had an ad for a while called, "Sometimes You Gotta Break the Rules." Outback Steakhouse, "No rules, just right." Don Q Rum, which none of you probably know anything about that. They had an advertisement that said, "Break all the rules." Neiman Marcus, any of you all ever go there? Okay, nobody will admit it at the moment. Neiman Marcus had one, "No rules here." Columbia House Music Club says, "We broke the rules." Comedy Central said, "See comedy that breaks the rules." Red Camel Cigarettes said, "This baby don't play by the rules." And even Woolite. Ladies, you all have washed your sweaters, right? In Woolite. Even Woolite did a campaign that said, "All the rules have changed." No Rules also turns up the name of a book and a CD and a tagline for NFL video games. No refs, no rules, no mercy. The message is everywhere. John Leo wrote, "The rules are for breaking," go the lyrics of a Spice Girl song. We started this series last week. It's called Twisted and Unseen. And the big idea of the whole series is that there is an invisible world that impacts our visible world. There's an invisible and unseen world that impacts the world that we can see. If we believe in God or heaven, we are halfway there. We already believe in an unseen world. We already believe there's a being who somehow impacts this unseen world. It's the other half of this that we tend to ignore. Last week, we used germs to illustrate this principle. The invisible germs that cannot be seen by the naked eye, they float around, they're carried everywhere in the air. Germs are invisible, and yet they have the potential to impact our visible world. We discovered that there's another invisible world that has the potential to impact us as well, not just physically, but it impacts our decisions, our relationships, the way we think about other things, the way we develop our worldview. We don't need a microscope to see the effects of this other invisible world like we do to see germs. What we need, you remember, is a... Thank you, a rearview mirror. Yeah, I know that doesn't look much like one, but we were trying to get it there, all right? All we need is a rearview mirror, because every one of us can look back at some moment in our life, a night, a weekend, a trip, a stage, a chapter of our lives, a relationship we had. We look back and now we say, "How could I have been?" Yeah, you've been there. How could I have been so blind to this? Some of us think back to the times in our lives when people warned us and they said, "Can't you see this is going to end in disaster?" And we really couldn't see it. We were genuinely deceived. It's not like we intended to destroy our lives. We weren't intent on going bankrupt. It just, at the moment, this made sense to us. Now we look back with hindsight and we say, "Wow, how could my thinking have been so twisted? Why couldn't I see that?" And the scriptures last week help us to answer that question. It says that beyond just our personality and beyond just the way we were raised and beyond self-awareness or the lack of self-awareness or all the things that we tend to blame our mistakes on, beyond that, there really is an invisible world, an unseen world, and it impacts our visible world. We opened the scriptures last week, and this was kind of like we went, "Whoa, Lord, what are you up to?" Because you see, we let Jesus speak to the heart of the issue directly. In the Gospel of John last week, chapter 8, Jesus tells us what he thinks about the unseen world. He gives us his take on the unseen world, and he was pretty straightforward and blunt about it. If you weren't here last week, just a little heads up. Jesus believes that there's a devil. Jesus believes that there's not just a God and heaven. Jesus believes there is something on the other side. His name is the devil, and the devil is a murderer. And the goal of the devil and the art form that he uses and the method by which he accomplishes his purpose is very simple. He uses deception because he is a liar. And Jesus said he's not only a liar, he is the father of all lies. He said that lying is his native tongue. He is the master twister. And he twists things just enough to get us off track without exposing to us the fact that there is a real personality called the devil and he's behind it all. If the devil would peek out behind the sign, you and I wouldn't fall for it. But he hides behind the twist. It's a little freaky. In fact, I even allowed us all to kind of push back from last week to say, do we really believe that? Can a modern person living in the 21st century believe there's a devil? And what it really boils down to, the final analysis is, do we believe Jesus Christ? For these are check it out in your Bible. The words are in red in John chapter 8. Jesus said it himself. In John 8, Jesus just called him out and he named him Satan. And at the end of last week, we even gave some national and international illustrations of that. And if you didn't get the message, you weren't here last week to hear it, please go online, listen to that, because it sets the framework of what we're going to talk about today in the next couple of weeks. What we're going to do today and for the next few weeks is we're going to look at some of the big twists that impact all of us. They're subtle, but they're big. Things have gotten twisted and confused us in our decision making. They've messed us up in our relationships and the way we think about such things like morality and ethics and everything else. Today I want to talk about this big subject that's really going to make you excited as soon as I announce it. We're going to talk about authority. Isn't that what we sung about? It was fun to sing about it, huh? I hope it'll be that much fun to preach about it. God, you reign, does he? Jesus, at the center of my life, is he? Don't answer yet. Wait till we get to the end. Then answer that question. You see, this is where it all really begins. Says who? Make me. Like most of you, I'm all for authority, especially when I get to be the authority. Right? I mean, isn't authority a good idea? I really think people should respond positively to the authority, especially when I get to be in charge. Children, obey your parents. I love that verse. When I had kids at home, it was one of my favorite verses. The kids we have at home right now are the best behaved they've ever been. We got Max and Herndon. That's our dog and our cat, all right? I like being in charge. I think authority's great when I get to be the authority. And like you, I think authority is great when authority supports my decisions. I mean, isn't it great to be able to call the police? That's much better than being chased by the police. I want to see the blue lights leading me rather than chasing me. See, I'm like you. I'm kind of for authority. But here's where the twist comes in. Somewhere along the way, and it's insidious in our culture, and it's been around since the Garden of Eden. You could go back and find it somewhere along the way. Here's the twist that Satan tricked us with. That when it comes to the subject of authority, when it comes to rules, our first response and the proper response is we need to evaluate the what. That's the twist. What am I being asked to do? What am I being required to do? What's our first response when somebody says, hey, will you do me a favor? What do we say? Depends. Not on who's asking for the favor, but what's the favor? If Shelly says, honey, would you do me a favor? I should never say, though I have, because I've been confused by the twist. I should never say, depends on what. That's the devil's lie. Whether it's parents, whether it's your boss, whether it's the government, whether it's the educational system, in whatever arena you're in where you have somebody telling you what to do, whether it's a situation where you've signed a contract or you work, you've taken a job for a company and organization where there are certain expectations, our first line of response to authority because of this twist is we always evaluate, what is it? What am I being asked to do? And the twist is, if I disagree with the what, then I can disregard the what without consequence. I'm going to simply disregard it. If I think that it's the wrong speed limit, I can just disregard it. I'm going to be on the freeway after the last service today. Shelly is going to be looking at my speedometer after this message. And she has a right to. She has a right to. This has been a sermon preparation filled with great, great conviction. This is tough. You see, if I disagree with it, if I think the policy handbook for the company is a little out of bounds, if it needs to be updated, a little antiquated, besides I don't see anybody else following these procedures, then it's certainly okay for me to disregard it. I don't feel guilty. I don't go to bed at night and confess it as sin. It doesn't even make a mark on my conscience because I evaluated and decided it's just a stupid rule. I'm sure God would second the emotion because he's far smarter than me. And if I can see how antiquated it is, if I can see how irrelevant it is, if I can see how impractical that rule is, certainly God can see it. God and me are over here going, dumb rule, what do you think? Second that emotion. I'm not going to obey it. God doesn't blame me and everything's fine. It doesn't even bother me. Why? Because my tendency, the way I'm oriented, because of the twist, we look at the rules and authority, and the first line of response is, let's evaluate what it says. What is it asking me to do? If I don't agree with it, I can get by with it. Then, baby, I'm free and it's not going to bother me a bit. Now, if I think I'm going to get in trouble, I might adhere to the principle, the rule, not because I agree, but I'm just trying to stay out of trouble. I just want to avoid the consequences. Now, if all we're talking about is should the curfew be 12 or 12:30, if it's, is this really a deduction or not? If this is about, let's get real personal and current, if this is about watering times, you know, if we're talking about a bunch of little things, if it was those kind of things, this wouldn't even be worth talking about. But this is a big, broad twist that impacts us at so many different levels. I mean, doesn't it become a little more emotional, a little more impactful when you think about a 16-year-old boy getting in a car with his buddies with a couple of six-packs? Because after all, this whole thing about underage drinking, I mean, you know, that's for somebody. Because I'm 16 and I've kind of controlled my own destiny for about 3 months now. I've evaluated this rule and I've decided it's a bad rule. So we're going to do it anyway. My buddies and I, we know there's this open container thing in the car, but you know, we think that's a bad rule, so we're going to disregard it. We think the whole thing about drinking and driving, that's probably a good rule for the average person, but baby, I am not average and I don't hang around with just average people. We looked at these three rules and we've decided, no, thank you. We're above that. And since we disagree with the rule, we feel empowered to disregard it. And then that 16-year-old thinks about some examples. Just like my father did when he filled out his income tax. Just like my mother does when she decides the doctor doesn't know what's best for her and her medication. So she has three doctors, and they don't know each other, and she gets all the prescriptions that she wants because what do doctors know about me after all? What do pharmacists know? I know better from them. I know legally there are some complications, but I disagree with the way the system is set up. I'm going to operate differently because I know best, not a twinge of conscience. Because when it comes to authority, it's all about, remember, in the twist, it's all about the what? The what? Now, surprisingly, when we open the scriptures, we find a little different paradigm. We find a different frame of reference. Here is where we unmask, or allow me to say, here is where we untwist the twist. I'll let you know up front, when we look at these verses, you are going to push away and you are going to be tempted to just shut down. Trust me. I've tried it all week long, and that's okay. In fact, today's sermon will probably give you something to talk about over dinner tonight. Hopefully, you'll dive into the scriptures and investigate this more for yourself. Some of you, as we go through these verses, you will think of exceptions. In fact, you're already beginning to set them up. But what about? But just if you would, for a few minutes today, focus on this principle because it is so very powerful. It is so very liberating once we allow this principle to seep in. Whereas the twist said, when it comes to authority and rules, it's all about the what. God says, no, it's not about the what, it's about the who. We need a bunch of owls here today. Who? Exactly right. Here's why. If you have your Bible, turn with me to the book of Romans, sixth book of the New Testament. The context, the setup for these verses is what makes this passage really, really powerful. Romans 13, let me tell you, this is rather unbelievable. What gives these words credibility is not just the fact that they're in the Bible, but the context in which these verses were written. The book of Romans is a letter, and it was written to Christians who live in, you guys are smart, That's why it's called Romans. These were written to Christians. There were not a lot of Christians in Rome in the first century. It was not a good place to live if you were a Christian. The emperor during this time, his name is Nero. I don't know if you remember anything about world history, but about Christians and Nero. They were not a very good mix. He burnt the city of Rome and he blamed it on the Christians. He burned Christians at the stake. He would light up his gardens at night with Christians who he had dipped in wax and would set on fire. He fed Christians to the lions. Christians did not fare very well under Nero. Obviously, Nero was a pagan. He was a terrible emperor. He killed part of his own family. He was a maniac. So he is in charge of the government. That is the setting in which Paul writes these words. Think about your worst time in the political history of this nation. I'm not asking for a commentary at the moment. Just simply think about the worst time in your life in this nation's history. It doesn't compare to what those Christians went through under Nero. So with that in mind, here's what Paul wrote to Christians living in Rome about this subject of God reigns. Who's the authority? Romans 13:1 starts out this way. Everyone, who's that omit? So who in this room gets a reprieve from this? Absolutely none of us. Everybody must, can you read that next word? Ooh, man, I can't believe you said it out loud. None of us like that word. Everyone must submit himself, herself, to the governing authorities. I'm reminded of Willis, all right? Remember the old sitcom on TV? What you say, Willis? That's kind of what I want to say right here. Well, what you say, Paul? Really? Really? You've got to have a timeout right here, don't you? I mean, we need to look at this rule. Rule by rule. That's the way we need to look at biblical principles, right? We need to look at the what one at a time and evaluate them. I mean, can you just make this blanket statement? You need to submit to the ruling authorities? Come on. Do you even know what our rules are here in Rome? Paul says, no. Here is the shift. I want to straighten out the twist. See, you think it's all about the individual law. I'm telling you, it isn't about the what. This is about who. And you need to submit. The who says you need to submit to the governing authorities. A little more information here. Next line. For there is no authority except that which God has established. Now, we just need a really big pause and let that settle in. Because it's kind of unbelievable. I mean, that's enough to make you want to take these pages and rip them out of your Bible. There's nothing more apparently wrong than this verse, so we need to take it out. There's no authority except that which God has established. Can you repeat that again, Paul? Paul says, yep, look at verse 2. Because he knew we would be just like this. So here's what he said. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Now certainly Paul must mean religious authority like the rabbi, the priest, or the pope. The preacher, no, it doesn't even go in that direction. All authorities have been established by God. He points us to a principle that you will find throughout scriptures. And again, if you pause long enough to let this sink in, this is such a powerful concept that it will make sense out of so much of life. It'll even help you make sense out of history. Here's what he teaches. Here's what the Bible teaches. God always works through human authority. Good human authority, bad human authority, righteous human authority, unrighteous human authority, believing human authority, unbelieving human authority. God works through human authority. That's how he exercises his will on this earth. And I'll give you some more examples in a few minutes, but just pause on this one for a moment. Parallel that verse with another verse in Romans chapter 8. All things work together for good. What kind of things? Just the good things work for good? No, the bad, the ugly, the things we cannot understand. God says all things. Here he says all authority. Submit. Good, bad, righteous, unrighteous, submit. You ain't liking this, are you? I'm not. Not one single bit. Paul says, look, it's not about what, it's about who. God exercises his will and his authority through the human authorities that he has allowed and that he has established, to which you and I say, okay, but wait. The implications of that are really kind of scary, because that's kind of like saying, if God established them, that means if I disobey my parents, or if I disobey or rebel at school, or if I do something that my company asks me not to do, or I don't do things right with the government, then the implication is that if I rebel or disregard those kind of things in my life, then that means I'm disregarding and rebelling against God. Really? I'm putting those things in the same line. You're making what I work at a spiritual issue? Yep. You're making my tax return a spiritual issue? Yep. Jesus, where? At the center of my life. You're making what I do at school a spiritual issue? God, you reign? Sure, that's not what you're saying. Well, verse 2, consequently, he who rebels against the authority is rebelling against who? What God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. That God has established the authorities in your life, and as bad as I may want to do this, and we've all done this to say, okay, God, you know, I'm not going to do this because that's stupid. I'm not going to do that because that's irrelevant. I'm not going to do that because my parents never really have understood what's going on in my world. I'm not going to do this because it doesn't make me happy. But God, I want you to know, I love you so much. I love to read your Bible, and I love your son, Jesus. Yes, I do. I love the spiritual thing that you and I got going on together. Don't you agree with me, Jesus? I just don't need to do any of those things because they're irrelevant. And Paul said, okay, big time out, guys. You're so deceived by the first big twist in history. This twist started in the Garden of Eden when the serpent said to Adam and Eve, hey, wait, guys, let's evaluate this whole thing that you can't eat from this one tree. You can eat from all the trees, but this one tree, I mean, does that really seem fair? Did God really say? They looked at the what, not the who. Does it even make sense that you shouldn't be able to eat from this tree? Look how good the fruit is. Well, now, what do you think about that? Well, let's just go ahead and eat the fruit. So God says to you and me this overarching principle. You ready? Here's the principle. That our attitude and our response to our human authorities is a reflection of our attitude and our response to our Father in heaven. Last week I asked you not to get mad at me because Jesus said it. Today I'm going to ask you, don't get mad at me. Paul said it. Okay? You see, our first response to the authorities that we can see is a reflection of our response to the authority we cannot see. And to think that somehow we can be out from underneath the authority of God has put over us and at the same time be under God's authority is a very confused notion. You can't be out from underneath the human authority that he has permitted and established and under God's authority at the very same time. This explains some of the things that we've experienced as a Christian because we so much want to divide things into two separate arenas. Let me tell you this. The more affluent you become and the more powerful in the workplace that you are, the more prone we are to fall for this twist. Because the more financial security we have, the more power that we wield, the more above the rules we feel, and the more powerful we are in our company, business, our industry, our department, our family, we begin to feel like the rules are for the little people, but not us. We forget, or maybe we never knew, this is a spiritual decision. This really isn't a God matter, we say. Since I'm in charge, I can do what I want over here. You and me, God, are fine, but I really don't need to keep those rules over there because these are two separate worlds. Paul says, no. That's twisted thinking. You think it's about your being asked to do. No, it's about who's asking you to do it. If there are authorities that God has placed over us, even temporarily in a company or a home or a school or the government, then to rebel against those authorities is like rebelling against your Father in heaven. Yikes. Verse 3. For rulers, this means, as if that wasn't enough, rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from the fear of one in authority? Then do what is right, and he will commend you. Now listen to this next verse. If you're a government official, if you are a business president, if you own your own company, if you're in education, you're a superintendent, a principal, a vice principal, a teacher, listen to the next verse. For he, the ruler, for he is God's servant to do good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword for nothing. He is God's servant and an agent of wrath to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. Now here's the big heads up. Your boss, who is like so non-religious, this isn't even funny. Did you know that he is God's servant? He is God's agent in your life? You're going, oh, not the boss I've got, Tim. You've never met him. Yeah, your boss. Even though he doesn't believe in God, that doesn't stop God. God works through human authority, period. Tim, are you telling me my parents are God's agents? My parents who've never darkened the door of the church, I had to find my way here all by myself. I don't know if they even care about church. My dad is anti-religion. He's God's agent? No way. Yeah, he is. In your life, he's God's agent. But that's not, but Tim, that they're not religious. It has nothing to do with religion. Paul's writing this to Christians living in Rome under Nero, certainly not religious. Because here's what Paul knew. God works through human authority, the good ones and the bad ones. To rebel against the authorities under which God is placed is the equivalent of rebelling against your Father in heaven. You're going, Tim, I have never heard a message like this before. I'll be honest, I've never preached one like this before either. But the reason we probably haven't is because of the twist. Tim, I'm not even sure I can swallow all this. Join the ranks. Of course we don't, because we live in a world that has believed in this big twist for so long that it's about the what. I mean, after all, we're Americans, right? The home of the brave, the land of the free. Besides, we're successful. We are so set up to be snookered by this twist. You know what the flip side is? If you're the boss, you're God's agent for the people who work for you. You go, no, Tim, we just manufacture stuff. This is nothing like doing work in church. Doesn't matter. If you're the boss of a manufacturing company, you are God's agent in their lives. Did you know that? If you're a public official, you are God's agent for the people you're responsible for. Isn't that amazing? You say, well, I don't like to think of it that way. I got two parts of my life. You don't understand. God works through human authority, whether they believe or recognize or not. Our attitude towards our own human authorities is a reflection of our attitude towards God, our Father in heaven, even though we may not realize it. Why? Because this is the way the who works in our lives. It's been really quiet in here. Because you know what all of us are doing? We're all thinking a little bit, oh my goodness, oh my gosh. If what Tim is saying is true, if what Paul has written is true, then that means, uh-oh. Hold on with me though, Paul's not finished. Verse 5. As if this wasn't enough, and he's almost done, thank God. Paul of verse 5 says this, therefore it is necessary to submit. There's that word again. Paul knows what we're thinking. He knows what we're thinking. This is cool. Therefore it's necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment. Time out. Isn't that what we do? See, I think that's a dumb rule, and I really don't want to keep it, but if I don't keep it, I'm going to get in trouble, so I'm going to keep it. So the only reason many of us submit to authorities around us is so we stay out of trouble. It's not because there is any spiritual connection or spiritual connotation to this. It's just, I want to stay out of trouble. As a kid, we would say, you know, my dad's going to kill me if I do that. Well, what if somebody said, your dad will never know? Would you go ahead and do it? So what we're saying, I'm saying that I'm not doing this because I agree, and I'm not doing this because I'm honoring my father. I'm doing this because I think my father is an agent of God, and I'm not doing this just to stay out of trouble. See, Paul takes us to the next level, and listen to what he says. Verse 5, it's necessary to submit to the authorities, not only because of possible punishment, but also because of conscience. Do you have one? Do you listen to it? As a Christian, when the Holy Spirit comes to live within our human spirit, He speaks to our conscience. And do we let our conscience listen to Him speak to us? This should be a matter of conscience, because the federal government is simply an agent of God. That doesn't mean they're godly, but they're an agent. I'll explain that more in a minute. It means that when you're taking a test at school and you have an opportunity to cheat and nobody's going to find out, it's not just about a matter of getting caught or not. This is a matter of conscience, because to cheat my teacher or to cheat the educational system is to try to cheat on God. You go, oh yeah, Tim, you are crossing some boundaries here. You're pulling too close a parallel. What about the grace you preach about? Man, because of this, I am really grateful for grace. More than ever. But read these verses for yourself. It means when you and your spouse have agreed on something about your family, you have an opportunity that you could cheat on that rule. I mean, I will never spend more than X amount of dollars, all right, without us talking about it. But you got a little extra in your pocket that she doesn't know about. I'm going to spend it. Hey, I am 8 states away. How's he going to know I had a one-night stand? It's not the what. It's the who you're responsible to. This is should be a matter of conscience, because ultimately we're not just accountable to our spouse or to our parents or to our boss or to our teacher or to the government. We are accountable to God, and he's placed us under these authorities. Paul writing this to the Christians in Rome. Then he gives us an illustration. Okay, I need about 8 minutes. Why he picked this illustration or application, I have no idea. Remember, I didn't write this. Notice how he drives this point home in verse 6. This is why you pay taxes. Can you believe that's in the Bible? Not written by a Republican or a Democrat. Written by Paul. He said, this is why. I wished he would have said, this is why you pay your tithes. Doesn't even bring it up. This is why you pay your taxes. For the authorities are God's servant. Paul, they're Romans. They're ungodly. You don't even live in Rome. You don't even know what the tax structure is like. I mean, how many times have you complained about paying your taxes and looked for ways legally and illegally to pay less? I've been listening to people for 50 years. I know I'm 60, but the first 10 years probably don't count. But for at least 50 years, I've listened to family, to friends, to other folks talk about, oh, I hate paying all these stinking taxes. Do you know what? Not once in 50 years has I heard anybody say, man, this is fun to pay my taxes. I think I'm going to pay more. Never heard that. Not once. But we pay our taxes. Why? Because Paul said, God says, they're my agents. Pay them. Now, if you think, okay, Tim, you've really started meddling today in church. It's okay for you to preach on prayer and loving your neighbor, but now you're talking about taxes. Paul brings it up. Just a little context. If you think the tax structure seems unfair right now, I assure you that if you don't pay your taxes, do you know what you're going to get? If you don't pay your taxes here in the United States, you know what you're going to get? You're going to get a letter. You're going to get a letter. You'll get a letter for months, maybe years, okay? Do you know what happened in Paul's day in Rome when they didn't pay their taxes that year? They didn't get a letter. They got a visit. And trust me, a visit is far worse than a letter. And then they would come and they would sell your wife and they would sell your children. And there might be some men who would say, no big deal. And then they would sell their property. And then they might say, you know what? You've paid your debt, you're free. Or they might say, you still owe us. And they would hang them. They would throw them in the pit. The first century Rome, especially if you're a Christian, and you're already on the bad list anyway, Paul says, hey, Christians in Rome, and this is why you pay your taxes. Listen. Pay your taxes. Not because they're just. Not because it's a godly government. Pay your taxes because it's the established authority by God at this moment. You cheat the government, you're cheating God. We pay our taxes not because they're fair, but because they're a representative, an agent of God. If you think you can be right with God and not pay, you're not paying attention to the New Testament, because remember, it's not the what, it is the who. The who. I need to jump ahead here. How can I do this so it makes sense? Sometimes people say, Tim, are you saying we should never question the authorities over us? Listen to my answer to that question. This is very important. You should always question the authorities above you. Always. But when you've fallen for the twist, when we question authority, we feel empowered to ignore the authority. When you get this straightened out in your mind, then we can question the authority and stay right underneath it. I think this is horrible. These are bad laws, unfair, bad rules. But I'm going to go along because this is not about me. It's about my Father in heaven. And for some reason, he's allowing this system to exist. So I'm going to question it. I'm going to complain when I can. I'm going to go to the voting booth as often as I can. I'm going to write letters when I can. I may even march in the streets when I can. But you'll never find me rebelling against them, because this isn't about what. This is about who. And remember, What was the government like and what was the religious system like when Jesus walked the earth? They both were responsible for his crucifixion. But did Jesus submit to the authorities over him in both cases? Yes, he did. Some people say, where is God when everything's going wrong? God says to them, I was saving the world with my son, Jesus Christ. If you were an Israelite in Egypt during captivity, and Pharaoh thought he was God and hated the God of Israel, and they were making gods with their own hands for the Egyptians to worship, somebody might have come along and said, where's God? And God would have said, I'm building a great nation. What did Pharaoh say about the Israelites when they were in captivity? He said, these Israelites, they breed like rabbits. They're outnumbering us. We got to control them before they take us over. What was God doing during all that? He was building a nation. So the day would come when he would take them across the Red Sea and he would take them across the Jordan and we'd give to them a land of promise. You see, when we don't think God is at work, he is. Who's in charge? I'm doing something. I'm trying to wrap this up so it makes sense. Listen, this is why it's so imperative for us who are Christians. We ought to be the best citizens in the United States of America, not because we don't ask the hard questions, but because we ask the hard questions absolutely under the authorities that God has established. Do you realize Daniel didn't go along with everything Nebuchadnezzar wanted him to do? He submitted to his authority, but he also submitted to the higher authority about the subject of prayer. You see, if you're going to challenge one authority, you have to stay under the authority. It's okay to challenge it. Daniel did. Hebrew children did. Jesus did. But he still remained under the authority. He accepted the consequence of the authority. There's an ultimate authority called God. This twist is powerful. We've all been taken in by it at some point or another. So here's my question to you as I wrap this up. What are you going to do with this when you leave here today? Suggest that some of you might need to write some letters. Some of you might even have to write some checks. Some of you might even need to get an attorney. Make one of those anonymous deals, all right? You owe a gazillion bucks, but they'll take this amount, all right? Why? Because you're coming clean. You realize these matters are spiritual issues. Our response to the rulers at work, that's a spiritual matter. Our response to the authorities at school, that's a spiritual matter. Our response to the authority at home, that's a spiritual matter. You cannot split these out because I promise you our attitude and responses to other authorities will be seen, and our attitude and responses to these things on earth will reflect our attitude of God in heaven. What is not seen impacts that which is seen. Let me close with this quote. Isn't it interesting? Oswald Chambers, Shelley read it Friday. I'm preaching this message Sunday. Listen to what Chambers said. There can be no real disobedience, nor any moral virtue in obedience, unless a person recognizes the higher authority of the one giving the orders. A person is simply a slave for obeying, unless behind his obedience is the recognition of a holy God. But woe is me if I refuse the light, if after seeing him, I still choose not to obey. Are there some authorities that you've ignored and you haven't seen in a spiritual matter? Maybe it's time you talk to God about that. Let's pray. Father, this is a big issue, and I probably didn't do it justice today. Paul said it simply in about 7 verses. I didn't say it so simply in 40 minutes. Father, parts of this is really hard. But the one thing I got out of this is it's not about the what, whether it's hard or easy. It's not about the what, whether I like it or not. It's not about the what, who is the one who says it on earth. It's about the who in the heavens. And Father, I want you to teach me in what areas that I've been weak in recognizing authority on earth. Teach us well, O Lord. May we have teachable spirits. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Guys, go have a good breakfast.